says Ahab reported to Jezebel everything that Elijah had done, including the massacre of the prophets. Jezebel immediately sent a messenger to Elijah with her threat. The gods will get you for this, and I will get even with you. By this time tomorrow, you will be as dead as one of those prophets. When Elijah saw how things were, he ran for his life far in the south of Judah. God's word for God's people. On tonight, I want to share briefly. I'm not going to keep you long unless the Lord says so. But I want to share from the Lord. God, I'm scared. God, I'm scared. Several years ago, there was a well-known TV circus show that featured a tiger act. And like the rest of the show, the act was done before a live audience. The trainer went into that cage with the tigers, and the door was locked behind him. The spotlights were on the cage. The television cameras moved in real close. And as the audience watched in suspense, that trainer skillfully put those tigers through their paces. In the middle of the performance, the worst thing possible happened. The lights went out. For 30 long seconds, that trainer was locked in that cage with those tigers. In the darkness, the tigers could see him, but he couldn't see them. A whip and a small chain, that didn't seem like much protection under those circumstances. But he survived. When the lights came on, he calmly finished his performance. In an interview afterwards, he was asked, "How did you feel, knowing that the tigers could see you, but you couldn't see them?" The trainer first admitted that he was afraid, but he pointed out that the tigers did not know that he couldn't see them. He said, "I continued cracking my whip. I continued talking to them until the lights came on, and they never knew the difference." That experience, my beloved, gives us a vivid parable of human life. At some point, all of us face terrifying tigers in the dark. Some of us face those tigers constantly. Do I have a witness? Amen. Have you ever said to God, "I'm scared"? So many people, they cope daily with those internal fears that are capable of destroying them. Yet they will not admit that they are afraid. They may not be able to visualize their fear or even understand them, but the fears have zeroed in on them to the point that they are ready to run somewhere and hide like Elijah did in the scripture. What are the tigers in the dark places of your life? What are those things that go bump in the night that cause you to lose sleep? Things that you perceive to have the potential to destroy you. You see, that's what fear is. Something we perceive as having the potential to destroy us. Remember the acronym, F-E-A-R, false elements appearing real. When tigers are real, as in the case of this story, or whether they are figment of our imagination, that's beside the point. If we perceive them to be real, then for us, that perception is a reality. Fear is fear. And if a person is afraid of something or someone, that fear can be just as immobilizing. It can be just as paralyzing. It can have just as much potential for self-destruction, whether that fear is real or whether it's imaginary. Telling somebody not to be afraid, that won't solve the problem. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I don't mind telling on myself. I got an issue with dogs. I don't dislike dogs. I'm simply afraid of dogs. I know they're supposed to be man's best friend, but they're not my best friend. The first thing I ask when I go to somebody's house for the first time is, "Do you have a dog?" And it doesn't help when folks say, "Oh, he won't bite you." They just don't understand, regular citizen. I would rather the dog bite me than to jump on me. I just have a fear of dogs. and their size, whether or not they have teeth, that doesn't even matter. I went to someone's house who had a 14-year-old dog. That's 91 in human years. That dog was blind and he was arthritic, but he sensed my fear and all of the people that were in that house. He came directly to me and started barking. And yes, I jumped up on the folks' leather sofa with a high-heeled shoes on. Then for the next time, put the dog away. And I'm not ashamed to tell you, it was presiding Elder Kelly's house. People are not afraid because they desire to be afraid. But they are afraid because they don't know how not to be afraid. If they knew how not to be afraid, they wouldn't be afraid. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
People who have phobias, fear of certain things such as heights and closed spaces and animals, they don't know how not to be afraid. Now, I know there's somebody in here that's quoting scripture in your mind. God didn't give us the spirit of fear, but that a power of love on a sound mind. Well, just hang with me a little while. We'll get to that. Telling somebody that he or she has nothing to fear, that will not solve the problem, because fear has its own logic. Do you believe that? And it can blind you to the truth. Fear will destroy reality. It will deaden you to common sense. It will dull your reasoning faculties. Fear will cause you not to see things as they truly are. Telling somebody that he or she has nothing to fear, that's good rhetoric, but it's bad medicine. Because fear in itself is a deadly enemy that can destroy you. In Italy during the 1600s, over 10,000 citizens died due to cholera. What was so amazing was the fact that only 800 actually died from the disease. The remaining 9,200 plus, they died from fear of dying from the disease. My brothers and sisters, we got to learn how to control and live with those tigers in the dark, or they will control and destroy us. Either we fix or face those fears, or they will fix or face us. Our text tonight is an illustration of this truth. Elijah had won a great victory for God on Mount Carmel. Yes, he had outprayed 450 prophets, yes. 400 of those who were Canaanite gods, with a number of followers, but they had no power.
Yes.
This mighty prophet of God, whose name was Elijah, had prayed down fire from heaven on Mount Carmel, and prayed rain down from the same skies to end a 3.5-year drought. Even though the prophets of Asherah and Baal, they had Elijah hopelessly outnumbered. And even though they prayed from morning to evening, they produced nothing but their own perspiration and fatigue. After the supremacy of Yahweh, the true and living God had been reestablished. The people who gathered at Mount Carmel, they revolted against the prophets of Baal and Asherah. When King Ahab, who was present on Mount Carmel, told his queen Jezebel of Elijah's actions, she swore to take Elijah's life within 24 hours. I'm sure you know a little bit about Jezebel. She was an evil woman. She had the reputation of getting just what she wanted. The Bible describes her as wicked. In Revelation, when Jesus sent the message to the church at Thyatira, he spoke of her as that woman who calls herself a prophetess, but she seduced his servants and caused them to commit fornication, and they sacrificed to idols. The wicked witch of the West, she had nothing on Jezebel. When Elijah heard of Queen Jezebel's threat, he started shaking in his boots, probably even wet his pants as he was running away. This great man of God, this awesome prayer boy, he lost it, y'all. And he ran into the wilderness because of his fear. I need you to see tonight just what fear can do to you. Even those folk who think that they are all of that and they ain't scared of nothing. Part of my work career was as a medical director in the Virginia Department of Corrections. I saw individuals who came in the system who thought they were bad. But when they got in the hands of some other inmates who were even better, things changed in her. Let us know two things about Elijah's flight. First of all, many theologians have made much of the fact that Elijah stood up to over 850 men on Mount Carmel. Yet he ran away from this one woman whose name was Jezebel. Logic would say that 850 men had more potential to destroy Elijah than Jezebel. Whether they did or not, that's beside the point. In Elijah's mind, Jezebel was greater than those 850 that he withstood. You need to know tonight, my brothers and sisters, that one can be bold about many things. They can be brave before many foes, and that yet they tremble and panic before one little thing. In other words, you don't need a whole lot of tigers in the dark. Just one tiger in your cage, it can put you on a run. Do I have a witness? You see, people who say they're not afraid of anything, they're doing one or two things. Either they're lying or they haven't met the right tiger yet. It's all right to say, God, I'm scared. Second, Elijah, who was the epitome of boldness and fearlessness, he panicked and he ran. I want you to know, saints of God, that anybody can lose it at some point or another. No matter how many tigers you face and who stood in the past, but the right tiger at the right moment, it can cause you to lose it. If you ever lost your composure, if you've ever been pushed beyond your limits, if your nerves have ever been in a frenzy, don't you dare be embarrassed. Welcome to the club, because everybody loses it at some time or another. At some point, at some time, in some way, it happens to all of us. And we have to say, God, I'm scared. I thought he was stronger than that. Yes, he is stronger than that ordinarily, but the right tiger came upon him when his strength wasn't as it normally is. I didn't think I'd ever see her break. Well, the right tiger got a hold to her and caused her to break. Notice, church, when Elijah ran, he ran to the right place. He ran to Mount Horeb, the mountain of God. He ran straight to the arms of God. What do you do when you lose it? What do you do when fear overtakes your faith? In those instances, my brothers and sisters, we ought to run to God. It was there at Mount Horeb that God spoke to Elijah. Not in the wind or the fire, but in a gentle comfort and communication, communion of a still small voice. As Elijah felt God's presence in silence, he was able to express to God his fears and his frustrations. He cried from the depth of his soul. He said, enough is enough. I've been zealous for you, Lord. The Israelites have forsaken your covenant. They have thrown down your altars. They killed your prophets with swords. I'm the only one left, and I'm fighting this fight all by myself. Now they're seeking to take my life. God, I'm scared. My brothers and sisters, fear will make you feel like giving up sometimes, won't you? You just get tired of fighting those tigers. You get tired of fighting tigers on the job, fighting tigers in your home, fighting tigers in the church. You get tired of fighting jealousy and pettiness tight. Fighting to make ends meet tight. Fighting the devil on every hand tight. And we say sometimes like Elijah, enough is enough. I give up and I don't want to try anymore. But see, what saved Elijah is that when he panicked and ran, he ran straight to the Lord, didn't he? He didn't run to another unfulfilling, unrewarding relationship. He ran to God. He didn't run to another eating, drinking, or shopping binge. He ran to God. What saved Elijah is that when he said enough is enough, he was talking to God and not another human being who was just as confused, who had just as many hang-ups as he did. No, he was talking to God. My beloved, the only way I know to handle the tigers in the dark, the only way I know to cope when fear sets in and panic. When I don't know where else to go, who else to run to, I run to God. I fall on my knees not leave right away. But don't be discouraged. Don't panic. Don't you dare throw in the towel. Trust God enough to know that in His own time, He will take care of those feet. The story is told about a missionary who was on a journey in Africa. He was kneeling at his bedside in prayer when a python lowered itself from the rafters of that bungalow and it encircled his whole body. That python made no attempt to constrict him. Yet the missionary knew that if he struggled, that serpent would tighten his claws and crush him to death. With self-control, with courage that was born out of faith, he went on quietly praying until the length of that snake unwound itself and went on back in the room. Sometimes, church, as we pray, fears will attack us. It will wrap itself around us as we come before God. That's why we need to learn not only how to pray, but we ought to learn how to pray through. You see, there's a difference in praying and praying through. Praying is talking to the Lord, but praying through is agonizing with the Lord. Praying through means that you're going to continue to pray until your deliverance comes. Praying through means that you're going to continue to pray until you gain the victory. When you're trying to overcome that fear, you are engaged in a warfare, and one battle will not win the war. You gotta keep on fighting on your knees over and over again until that fear releases that hope and crawls back from whence it came. To pray through is to be just as determined to get your victory as fear is determined to overcome you and the devil determined to defeat you. To pray saying like Jacob, who wrestled with the angel all night long. I don't care how long it takes. I don't care how many times I gotta pray and hold to you. I will not turn you loose until you bless my soul. To pray through is to say like that woman with the issue of blood, who was sick for 12 years, the one who had been to every doctor in town, but she got no better. But one day, church, she heard Jesus was coming to town. She had faith enough to believe, if I could get close enough to touch the hem of his garment, I shall be healed. There will be times when you have to pray through sorrow to get to your son. Pray through midnight to make it over to the morning time. You got to pray through tears to get to your testimony. Pray through weeping to make it all the way inside. I heard the psalmist when he said, weeping may endure for a night. But if we hold on to God, joy is coming in the night. Elijah prayed through. He prayed through church. And God heard him. He spoke to him. And he said these words, go to the wilderness of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Anoint Jehu as king over Israel. Anoint Elisha in your place. And by the way, Elisha, regarding your concern that you're the only one left, not so. Don't get it twisted. Because there's 7,000 folk in Israel who have not bowed to me. Pray through, church. Even though fear might try to overtake you, you can face those tigers in the dark because God is right there with you and He will not let any weapon form prosper. As I take my seat, let me tell you that as a child, I was afraid of everything, but especially in the dark. I always thought that some monster would come from under my bed and devour me. I would call my daddy in the middle of the night. He would simply come, stand at my bed. He'd put his hand on my back and he just looked down on me, knowing that he was at my bedside and his eyes were upon me. I would fall asleep peacefully and all of my fears were gone. Well, I stopped by St. Paul tonight to tell somebody that you can face your tigers in the dark when you know that beyond them, there's another set of eyes watching over you. His name is Jesus. Jesus. You never spoke to how you never speak. Even though those titles can see you better than they can, you can see them, there's no need to fear. Because his eyes are watching their every move. And he's right there to protect you. I never know what the songwriter meant when he said, oh, night time, all day, I've got angels watching over me. I don't care what looks in the dark. I got angels watching over me. I don't care how many titles come my way. I got angels, and they're watching over me. I don't worry about who tried to do me harm. It won't work because angels are watching over me. I thank God tonight that he's my sword and my shield. He's my strong tower. He's my deliverer. He's my on the everlasting. Thank you, Jesus.